para consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio rules out running for a national post in 2022.
Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan says President Duterte's apology for his administration's shortcomings is not enough.
Philippine Senator Panfilo Lacson says possible testimony from a new Senate witness could break the Farmily contract wide open and unmask individuals involved in the controversial deal.
The Professional Regulation Commission cancels the medical board exam in Metro Manila due to rising COVID-19 cases.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Cruz.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story.
Mm-hmm.
Senator Panfilo Lacson says more details may soon be revealed in the Blue Ribbon Committee's probe on the government's pandemic response spending. That's as he calls on his fellow senators to stand their ground despite attacks from President Duterte. The chief executive has constantly slammed the Senate, saying lawmakers are only using the hearings to gain traction in the upcoming elections. But Lacson is unfazed. He reveals a new witness may unmask the real people behind the questionable deals worth billions of pesos.
Not even the President of the Philippines can tell the Senate what to do. We will do and exercise our mandate, and especially yung oversight. You'll be surprised, we're working on something that would further open up itong kaso ng Barmali. I hope pagka nag-testify yung sinasabi ko, sabi ko mag-o-open up lahat, maraming mabubuksan dito. So I just hope that the chairman of the Blue Ribbon Committee as well as my colleagues will still continue with this investigation.
Senator Aimee Marcos is seeking to abolish the procurement service of the Department of Budget and Management and the Philippine International Trading Corporation, saying these agencies have become a breeding ground for corruption. ABS-CBN correspondent Katrina Domingo joins us on the line for details. Kat?
Denise, that's right. Senator Aimee Marcos is alleging that systemic corruption has already crippled these two agencies, the PSBBM and the PITC, which were both created during the presidency of her father, former President Ferdinand Marcos. In two separate Senate bills filed earlier this week, Marcos said that the PSBBM has become a fertile breeding ground for graft and corruption and should be abolished as it has already outlived its functions for the national government. Marcos also says that there are reports that source agencies have been using the PITC to park their funds so that they can generate savings, which in turn can be used by other agencies to fund bonuses of several government officials. Now, aside from reports of corruption within these two agencies, Marcos noted that the passage of the Government Procurement Reform Act in 2002 already undermines the mandate of both the PSBBM and the PITC, as the law already allows all agencies to establish a single bids and awards committee for our procurement. Just a brief context for our viewers. The PSBBM was created on August 1978 to establish an integrated procurement system for the national government to take advantage of economies of scale, while the PITC was created in July 1973 with a primary mandate of facilitating trade with socialist and other centrally planned economy countries. Marcos says that as of today, only two centrally planned economies are in existence, which are Cuba and North Korea, respectively. She says the Philippines has already moved away from government-to-government trade, so the PITC has basically become archaic and irrelevant in the current time. Now, so far, Denise, the two Marcos bills have yet to be heard in Senate committees. The Senate needs to first pass those measures both on the committee level as well as on second and third reading before they can submit it for the president's signature for approval. Denise?
Thank you, Kat.
President Duterte again volunteers to step down from office, but only if the Senate can prove government's pandemic funds were lost to corruption. Senators are currently investigating the government's procurement of allegedly overpriced pandemic supplies.
Sasabihin ko sa inyo, kung totoo man yan, I will resign. I will resign. Kung si Duque, kinorap niya, or anybody in the executive department. Particularly, of course, maski malayo ako sa mga transactions dyan, being the president of the executive department and of the country, talagang mananagot ako.
Duterte also apologized for any shortcomings in government's pandemic response. But the medical community says he should just stop giving excuses.
Bumenta na yon. I think that kind of argument of having no playbook. was acceptable, maybe in the first 6 months of this particular pandemic. But we have had 18 months of experience. And at this point, we should have written our own playbook already.
We're still not able to, for example, develop a certain level of standardized response. And that speaks of leadership. That speaks of the way all things are being coordinated.
Senator Francis Pangilinan also believes Duterte's apology is not enough. Speaking to Teleradio, Pangilinan argued there are existing laws against plunder and corruption that may be applied if there are irregularities in the handling of pandemic funds.
Sorry kung sorry at sa bilyong-bilyong halagang binubulsa o yung overprice, kaya lang ka namang manood lang kami at magsabing, sige, pasensahan tayo. Sinasabi nila, ito na lang siguro isang punto, na nagmamadali, di ba? Kaya kinakailangan. Maaari tayong maniwala ron. Eh bakit hanggang 2021 meron pang purchases sa Parmalee? Nagmamadali pa rin hanggang 2021.
The senator adds Duterte can't just declare that government's deal with Farmally was above board. He also says there is information Farmally secured other contracts aside from the $8.7 billion deal for personal protective equipment. Pangilinan is also wondering why President Duterte has repeatedly defended businessman Michael Yang.
Ang biro nga eh. Ano ba ito? Ito ba eh ang Michael Yang Palace? Michael Yang Palace. Alam mo, ito si Michael Yang, talagang maraming tanong dito dahil nasa Pogo din siya eh. Tapos yung vaccination, may mga balita na yung mga Pogo workers na Chinese nationals eh may sariling vaccination program.
Yang, who is Duterte's former presidential economic advisor, has signified he will attend the next Senate probe. This comes after the Senate issued an arrest warrant against Yang and other Farmally officials for snubbing the inquiry.
Philippine authorities hope to resume face-to-face classes in least risky areas as soon as possible. During a Senate hearing, National Economic and Development Authority Chief Carl Tua said they presented plans to pilot test in-person learning before the interagency COVID task force. Tua said these plans were approved by the task force but were deferred due to infection surges. Senator Sherwin Gatalian, who chairs the Senate Basic Education Committee, is in favor of pilot testing face-to-face classes in areas with no COVID cases. He says there are 200 local governments without infections.
A group of local businessmen supports the postponement of the new granular lockdown system in Metro Manila. Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion says authorities can use this time to iron out guidelines and make them less complicated.
If you can keep it to GCQ1 and GCQ2, but if you really have to, then you leave it to three levels. Masyadong detalyado na yung 1, 2, 3, 4. Eh. What will determine a restaurant to operate at 20%, at 40%? But to go by super granular as to the sitio or whatever, or this building will be GCQ1. Ang gulo, no.
The Management Association of the Philippines meanwhile backs Concepcion's proposal allowing greater mobility for people who have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19.
If we're able to start with the incentives, mobility incentives for the fully vaccinated, it will help. The NCR contribution to GDP is somewhere in the order of 32%. Mm. And if you add Calabarzon, it hits 46%. So imagine if you can just even get half the people who used to work to be able to work. It's going to create a lot of activity.
Some local governments in Metro Manila are now preparing for the vaccination of children aged 12 years and above. Marikina City has begun making a master list of eligible minors. This comes after the Philippine Food and Drug Administration approved the use of Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine for that age group.
Sa Marikina, sa 78 o 80% na nga kami ng binabakunahan. Wala na kami mabakunahan na adult population. Talagang yung mga kabataan na, yung mga pediatric na ang kailangan bakunahan.
The municipality of Pateros has also opened up vaccine registrations for 12 to 17 years old. So far, 86% of Pateros' population is already fully vaccinated.
Marami rin kaming hinahandang mga dokumento dahil kailangan din pumirma ng consent ang magulang. Ano?
Ayun.
At sila isasamahan din at to a certain point sa loob ng vaccination center para matiyak namin na talagang pumapayag po yung magulang.
122 people, including 99 children, have contracted COVID-19 at an orphanage in Quezon City. Dr. Rolando Cruz, chief of the city's epidemiological surveillance unit, says an asymptomatic adult allegedly visited the orphanage and caused the outbreak. The local government of Quezon City is now sending medicines, hygiene kits, and food bags to the orphanage.
The Professional Regulation Commission postpones the upcoming Physicians Licensure Examination, or PLE, in Metro Manila amid rising COVID infections. In a Facebook post, it said the PLE, originally scheduled on September 11, 12, 18, and 19 in the capital region, have been canceled. But the exams scheduled on the same dates in other regions will still proceed. Affected examinees in the NCR may take the next succeeding examination without forfeiture of their examination fees. Students groups earlier called for the postponement of the board exam due to the pandemic threat.
Moving now to COVID updates overseas, Japan is set to extend the emergency COVID-19 restrictions in Tokyo and in a number of other prefectures until the end of the month. Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga will make a formal decision later today, after this is ratified by a panel of experts. 21 of Japan's prefectures are currently under a state of emergency until September 12th. But the curbs have failed to sufficiently decrease the number of new infections in Tokyo and its surrounding cities. Japan reported 1,800 new COVID-19 cases Wednesday.
Australia unveils a roadmap for easing Sydney's months-long lockdown. Authorities say bars and restaurants, as well as gyms, will be able to reopen at a reduced capacity once 70% of people in New South Wales get fully vaccinated by mid-October. So far, about 43% of the eligible population had been fully vaccinated in New South Wales.
We know that case numbers are likely to peak in the next week or so, and we also know that our hospital system will be under the greatest stress in October. However, we also know that living with COVID means you have a cautious and staged reopening once you get to those high rates of vaccination in your adult population.
The plan comes as COVID cases continue to surge in the state due to the Delta variant. The state reported 1,405 new local cases Thursday, along with five fatalities. Still ahead, the president's daughter, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio, rules out a possible presidential run in 2022.
And the country's trade deficit widens in July. More news when we return.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Thank you.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back. Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio ruling out a possible presidential run in 2022. That's after her father, President Rodrigo Duterte, accepted the PDP Laban nomination for him to run as vice president. In a text message to reporters, Duterte Carpio said she is not running for a national position in 2022. She asserted only one Duterte will gun for a national post next year. The Davao City Mayor also said she will no longer support the administration ticket of PDP Laban in 2022, the way she did in the 2019 midterm elections. Duterte Carpio has topped recent presidential election surveys. At least 7 parties have also declared support for her as a presidential candidate.
The decision has been made, but for supporters of the Davao City Mayor, there's still time to change her mind. Former Camarines Sur Representative Rolando Andaya believes the younger Duterte will eventually run, and she just wants to have the freedom to choose her running mate.
The PDP Laban faction, led by Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi, asserts the legality of their convention held Wednesday in Pampanga. During that event, the ruling party formally nominated the tandem of Senator Bongo and President Duterte for 2022. But Go insisted he has no plans to run for president. The faction also added later Representative Lucy Torres Gomez to its initial senatorial slate, which consists mostly of cabinet members.
It will be a very interesting lineup, a colorful one, and may iba personalidad po. Meron lang po, yung mga ilang po na makasama pa dyan, meron lang po mga tinatapos na personal na mga kailangan ayusin at mga legal na kailangan ayusin. Pero meron na po, may mga ready naman po.
The Cusi wing believes their convention should be the only one recognized by poll officials. It earlier asked the Commission on Elections to declare as illegitimate the group led by Senators Manny Pacquiao and Coco Pimentel. The faction that will fail to get the poll body's approval would have no right to issue certificates of nomination needed to run under a party.
Unfair. That's how presidential candidate Senator Panfilo Lacson is describing accusations he is an enabler of the Duterte administration. Critics say Lacson only recently began speaking out against President Duterte on alleged corruption in government and the bloody war on drugs. Lacson refutes this.
Bakit ba nakulong at na-convict yung pumatay kay Kian de los Santos? I spearheaded the investigation in the Senate, which led to the gathering of the evidence against the policemen concerned. Nakakalimutan ng mga tao because nadadrown out ng mga propaganda dahil nga meron nag-inject o nag-create ng nag-invent ng word na enabler in-attach sa akin. And I won't admit that because even earlier in the campaign of this administration against illegal drugs, I was calling them out. But you know, kung tama naman yung pag-implement doon sa kanilang drug war. I was also supporting them, especially the police, where I came from.
On Wednesday, Senator Lacson formally launched his bid to run for president along with running mate Senate President Vicente Soto III.
Former Senator Antonio Trillanes IV puts his faith in Vice President Lenny Robredo's winnability. On Twitter, Trillanes said he strongly believes Robredo would win if she decides to run for president next year. Trillanes has submitted his name for consideration as the Sambayan Coalition's possible presidential bet. However, he will give way to Robredo if she decides to run. Robredo has yet to reveal her 2022 political plans.
The Philippine Commission on Elections declares a failure of bidding for the lease of 10,000 additional vote counting machines for the 2022 elections. Only Smartmatic bought bid documents but failed to submit a bid offer due to a sharp increase in electric components and logistics cost. But Smartmatic assures the poll body it can deliver the machines if the COMELEC decides to amend the budget. The lease project has a total approved budget of over 600 million pesos. The additional machines were supposed to lower the machine-to-voter ratio per polling place.
Clearer guidelines, that's the appeal of Metro Manila mayors to the Pandemic Task Force on the implementation of the proposed granular lockdown. This comes as the last-minute withdrawal of the shift to the granular lockdown triggered public frustration and outrage. Let's talk now to Marikina Mayor Marcelino Teodoro on how government can simplify lockdown protocols. Mayor Marcy, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron, and good afternoon to our viewers.
Now you've asked the national government for clearer, simpler guidelines. We do want to hear from you, your recommendations for them to come out with clearer guidelines, sir.
Yeah, that is correct, Ron. We're asking and we're appealing to the interagency task force for a more clear and simpler lockdown criteria. One is that there are so many alert levels, and we are asking for 2 to 3 only alert levels wherein we could fully understand the parameter that will be used in terms of number of cases in an area as well as presence of the variant in a particular area. Secondly, we would like to be clarified on how will be the sharing in terms of providing the resources needed in a lockdown area. Those things are being discussed, and we hope that will be clearly addressed by the IATF. Thirdly, what metric of evaluation will be used in order to determine the effectivity of having a granular lockdown against that of having a quarantine classification for a larger area. This is to balance the concern of health and of our economy, local economy in particular.
I just want to go back to one of those you pointed out, the sharing of resources. Does this pertain to the assistance given to the residents who will be affected by a lockdown?
Correct, Aaron. We're pertaining to that aspect. How are we going to provide the necessary assistance, not only in terms of the food provision that will be needed in the area, but more importantly, the special needs that will be required by a family that will be in a lockdown area if they have medical requirement. And also, we would like to be clarified on how the national government can help the LGUs in the operation of our treatment, various treatment and quarantine facilities in our locality. The importance of having a granular lockdown is that we should be able to improve on the turnaround period for detection and isolation and eventually treatment of the people affected in the lockdown area. And more importantly, the mechanism on where they could be reintegrated again to the community and to provide the economic activity that would sustain their livelihood prospectively.
Right. I've heard you raise a couple of issues with the guidelines for the granular lockdown before, particularly with the hospital utilization rate of a city where non-residents confined in a city hospital will be counted in that utilization rate. You're also concerned about having a business establishment included in a granular lockdown. How would that be if people who work there are coming out, are coming from another city and have to go inside that city? Now, IATF had mostly listened to the recommendations of Metro Manila mayors before, especially in quarantine classifications. But didn't this task force coordinate with the mayors before they came out with the guidelines for granular lockdowns?
We must admit that we were consulted prior to the declaration or pronouncement of the lockdown period, being the lockdown is a pilot, will be pilot tested in Metro Manila for a period of 2 weeks. Indeed, we were consulted, but we're asking what the mayor, Metro Manila mayors were asking, is a clear guideline, a written guideline that we could not only study how to implement it effectively, but more importantly, would guide us in our action in the implementation of the granular lockdown. Ito yung nawala, ito yung hindi na ibigay. And they had this emergency meeting last Tuesday afternoon on the eve of the implementation of the shift in the policy. And they decided that it will be deferred for the next 2 weeks in order to have a clearer guidelines and also in order to incorporate the inputs and other recommendations of the Metro Manila mayors. Ito yung naging problema, the indecisiveness on the part of the agency also consistency in terms of prior to the pronouncement, there should be a clear, not only clear guidelines, but a mechanism in place that can implement effectively the guidelines to be or the policy that will be announced.
Mm-hmm. Now, they've extended MECQ in the NCR, which could give them a couple of weeks to iron out the guidelines. But were you okay with that, with the extension of the MECQ while they are fixing the guidelines for the granular lockdowns?
We're okay with the extension of the MECQ, but we also call for the liberalization of some of the economic activities in our communities, in our particular LGUs. The problem really, Ron, is not only the increasing number of active cases of COVID in our areas, but the increasing number of people who are now experiencing hunger and hardship in terms of their livelihood. Nagiging mahirap eh. Kaya we're asking that we revisit also the negativities of establishments under the Department of Trade and Industry and to allow some of the establishments to operate with compliance to minimum public health standard and giving paramount importance to safety against COVID, increasing COVID cases, Ron. The other thing that we are trying to clarify the Metro Manila mayors with the declaration of granular lockdown in a particular area, Ron, is that what basis are we going to use? One of the bases that being used is the determination of the hospital utilization
rate. Yeah.
And we're questioning that. For example, in our case, we have one regional hospital here. We have 525 active cases of COVID in that particular hospital. Before this interview, I got the actual report of admission of COVID cases in the said hospital. That is among Rodriguez Memorial Medical Center located in Marikina. More than half of the cases admitted in the said hospital are non-residents of the city, and that would show the fact that using hospital utilization rate as basis for declaration of granular lockdown is faulty already on that basis. So yun yung mga nililinaw namin eh, maapektuhan kami nung ganung mga parameter that is not really corresponding to the actual condition on the ground.
Would you want them to take out that parameter?
Yes, definitely. We're asking the interagency task force to take out that parameter. And secondly, the second parameter that they're trying to put forward is that the presence of the Delta variant in a particular area. We know that the reporting that we're receiving from the DOH coming from the Philippine Genome Center is not really updated. Most of the cases that are being reported already to the LGU are already old cases. Yung iba gumaling na yung mga ano eh, yung mga nagkasakit eh. Kaya sabi namin, paano namin gagamitin ito? There should be a more practical basis for the declaration of the granular lockdown in a particular area, since livelihood not only that we need to address the rising cases, but more importantly yung kabuhayan ng tao ang maapektuhan eh.
When you mentioned a while ago about the liberalization of economic activities, does that mean you're in favor of the proposed vaccine bubbles and greater mobility for vaccinated people?
Yes, Ron, that will help us a lot. I think it's very practical. It's a practical solution to improve the rate of our vaccination. Likewise, we have proven already based on experiences and based on facts given by science that vaccines are basically safe to use and effective in avoiding or preventing severe cases in case of contamination or transmission.
Mayor Marcelino Teodoro of Marikina City, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ron.
More to come, the Taliban appeals for humanitarian aid for Afghanistan.
We will take a short break. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Philippine trade deficit widens to $3.29 billion in July from $2.83 billion in June. Total export sales posted a slower increase of 12.7%, amounting to $6.42 billion. Imports, meanwhile, grew at a faster rate of 24% to $9.71 billion. The rise was driven by an increase in imports of nine of the top 10 major commodity groups, led by mineral fuels, iron, steel, and transport equipment. China was the Philippines' top export partner, followed by the U.S., Hong Kong, Japan, and Singapore.
Philippine House lawmakers flagged the unspent funds of the Agriculture Department. During the hearing on the agency's proposed 2022 budget, House Deputy Speaker Bernadette Herrera D. said as much as 19 billion pesos in funds of the National Irrigation Administration remain unused. Magsasaka Party List Representative Argel Cabatbat meanwhile mentioned a commission and audit report on the unutilized funds. But the agency asserts it has already addressed COA's findings. The Agriculture Department is asking for a 91 billion peso budget, 30 billion more than this year's spending.
The budget utilization for the period 2020 is almost 92%. For this year, up to August 15, 2021, the budget utilization is more than 55%. And there's still the remaining fund of about 35%. But we still have remaining months for this year. On the COA report, we have already made representations to COA and have done point-by-point responses to the COA findings, which we have already sent to them. All of their findings have been adequately responded to by our finance and administration undersecretary.
The Philippines' manufacturing output accelerates in July, again outpacing the growth in the previous month. Government data show the value of production index grew by 528%. This is compared to the 444% growth recorded in June and a reversal of the 74% contraction in July last year. The volume of production index also went up nearly 538% in July, exceeding the 459% growth in the previous month. It is also a complete reversal of the nearly 73% decline recorded for the same period in 2020. The Philippine Statistics Authority attributes the growth in factory output to increases in the manufacturing of coke and refined petroleum products.
Approved foreign investments in the Philippines reached 22.5 billion pesos in the second quarter of the year. That's higher compared to the 15 billion logged in the same period last year. The Philippine Statistics Authority says the commitments were mainly driven by investments from the UK, South Korea, and the US. It adds the ICT industry stands to receive some 12 billion pesos, or more than half of the total pledges, followed by the construction and manufacturing sectors.
The country's third designated telco, Dito Telecommunity, hopes to get 6 million subscribers by the end of the year. Dito's chief administrative officer, Adel Tamano, says the firm is getting 20,000 subscribers daily. It currently has 2.6 million subscribers since beginning commercial operations in March.
It took us, how long did it take us, Genboy, to reach our first 1 million mark?
Parang 3 months.
Maybe 3 months. And then, and then 2 million.
Four months.
Yeah, then 2 million, it took us about
one and a half.
And now it's we're getting the additional million in about a month's time. So nag-improve yung numbers, especially as we're becoming more and more available na sa market.
The telco adds it has passed its second technical audit, offering internet speeds of up to 89 Mbps for 4G and 853.85 Mbps for 5G. It also covers more than 52% of the population. Dito was required to offer internet speeds of 55 Mbps with a population coverage of 51%.
The PSE Index breaks its two-day winning streak as foreign funds continue to trudge out of the local bourse. Rain Musking reports.
Philippine shares failed to sustain their two-day rally, the main index shedding nearly 0.4% to close at 69.24. Value turnover was light at just 4 billion pesos. Regina Capital Development Corporation says the local bourse slid following Wall Street's weak finish overnight. Foreign funds sold out of the Philippine market for the second day. James Cho of HSBC Private Banking and Wealth Management in Singapore says they are keeping a neutral call on Philippine equities for now.
Well, I think Philippine equities have done very well over the last month or so. Therefore, I think for it to rise even further from here, it's going to be fairly challenging. There will be some headwinds, of course. The pandemic situation is one just with all parts of Southeast Asia. But also what's important is also that the factors that is actually supportive of Philippine equities is actually that valuations, despite the rise over the last month, is still fairly attractive vis-a-vis its own history. So I think by and large at this stage, given that it has risen a lot, we hold a neutral call on Philippine equities as of now.
Meanwhile, as a trade deficit widened for July, RCBC chief economist Michael Ricafort says trade is still one of the bright spots in the economy and will only improve as the country reopens.
The reopening of the economy is a focus right now, especially in view of the more localized or granular lockdowns, it would be a de facto reopening of the economy. If that's the case, imports could still grow.
He also expects the planned 2 billion peso initial public offering of Mediline's distributors to do well as demand for healthcare and medical equipment rise. Among the most active stocks, AC Energy, Advanced, after reporting that its subsidiary, ASEN Finance Limited, has completed the issuance of $400 million in fixed-for-life green bonds, allowing it to raise fresh capital of close to $1 billion for 2021. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
The heirs of the late mall tycoon Henry C. topped Forbes' list of the 50 richest Filipinos. The magazine said the C's, who collectively own the country's largest mall empire, SM, have a combined worth of over $16 billion. Property tycoon Manny Villar came in second place with a net worth of $6.7 billion. Ports magnate Enrique Arazon ranked third with an estimated wealth of $5.8 billion. Other billionaires included in the list are Converge CEO Dennis Anthony Uy and his wife Maria Grace, Jollibee founder and chairman Tony Tan Caktiong, and Alliance Global boss Andrew Tan. Forbes says the tycoons included in the list staged a robust recovery this year and saw their collective wealth rise by 30% to $79 billion.
Bitcoin sell-off eased on Wednesday following a flash crash. It has recovered to around $46,000 after dropping to below $43,000 on Tuesday. Ether also rebounded following a two-day rout. Some analysts were citing what they called glitched rollout by El Salvador for Tuesday's massive sell-off. There were initial bugs impacting the new digital wallet in the country. Protests also erupted across the country, opposing Bitcoin's adoption as legal tender. In the U.S., cryptocurrency exchange Coinbase Global fell 3.2% after securities regulator threatened to sue the firm if it goes ahead with plans to launch a crypto lending scheme.
The Taliban appealing for humanitarian aid from regional countries to rebuild Afghanistan as soon as possible. The Taliban says some 30 to 50 million Afghans are in need of food and other help. The group acknowledges this is just one of several challenges faced by the new government.
They are living under the line of poverty line. So this is a challenge and a priority for us. Second is our priority to build peace in the country. And third is and the most important, our priority is to reconstruct Afghanistan. And that is not possible to be done properly without assistance from neighboring countries, including China and other countries.
Meanwhile, 200 Americans and other civilians who remained in Afghanistan at the end of evacuation operations have reportedly been allowed by the Taliban to leave on chartered flights from Kabul. A U.S. special representative reportedly pressed the Taliban to allow the departures. The flights are expected to leave starting Thursday.
At least three people have been killed and 31 others remain missing due to Tropical Storm Jolina. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council says the fatalities were reported in Masbate province. More than 20,000 families were affected by Jolina in Central Luzon, Mimaropa, Bicol region, Western and Eastern Visayas, and Metro Manila. Over 3,540 houses were damaged, while nearly 300 were totally destroyed. Damage to agriculture is more than 206 million pesos.
Sports News Now, Filipino tennis sensation Alex Ayala advances to the quarterfinals of the U.S. Open Juniors Tournament. She defeated Greek opponent Michaela Lachi. Ayala was a game away from an early exit in set two, but she bounced back to reach the next round. Ayala and Filipino-Canadian Leila Fernandez have been a source of Filipino pride at the tournament. The 19-year-old Fernandez, who is competing in the seniors division, is set to play in her first Grand Slam semifinal.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.
mobility will be key.